I could go on and on. Has been awarded at WI NPRs for her work in social entrepreneurship. Graduate of Wharton, so lots of hats and lots of achievements. To my left is Sada Saz Siddiqui. Sada is a writer, entrepreneur, an activist, and poet from Bangladesh. She studied molecular biology, grew up in the UK, studied molecular biology, went back to Bangladesh, joined Citgo Limited, which is a large manufacturer and exporter of garments, and has also recently written her own poetry, is a co-founder of the Hay Festival in Dhaka, and mentioned something else recently.
And a past magic.
Yes, and also has a past magic income. Priya is another remarkable woman. Priya, sorry, but my notes. Owns a bookshop, editorial director at Rooney Books. Rooney Books specializes in illustrated books on art and design. And I think what we are looking to do with Owen is having a bookshop. It's building a community of readers and people who share that passion for literature and reading. And I love the name of the bookshop, CM.E. I'm not going to explain what that means and how you do it. I'm going to let the walk through their journey a little bit. But broadly speaking, I think the themes that we want to cover today are what do we mean when we talk about entrepreneurship? I mean, how do we define it? What does that mean for each of us? Then what does it mean to be a woman and an entrepreneur in South Asia? We have this perception outside South Asia and the subcontinent that women here are downtrodden or oppressed, and yet we have such a rich history and heritage of incredibly strong women going back centuries. We've had heads of state, we've had warriors, generals, empresses, poets, activists. So, you know, how do you sort of counter this myth? I'm going to throw you over to our panelists. Please tell us a little bit about your journey. Roshan, yours especially is quite interesting because microfinance is such a finance, it's a boys' club completely. And as we were talking earlier, microfinance is a boys' club within a boys' club. So how did you manage to sort of get into this area and really, you know, not get swallowed up here?
Umar, it's a very interesting question, and I have to go back years to really get around this issue. When I was in public here, my professor at development economics grudgingly gave me an A over my peers, most of whom were men. And that started triggering in my mind this question of why are perceptions around South Asian women so negative? A year later, when I went back to meet him to tell him that I got my job, landed a job at the World Bank, the first question he asked me, have you come here to give me your wedding invitation? So I mean, that whole question, that whole paradigm made me realize that the odds against us are quite high when it comes to perceptions. Reality and perceptions are very different. You know, the debate on this is whether, if you look at the recent write-ups on this, or recent processing around this issue, you have Anne-Marie's law firm to say, well, you can't have it all. In life, you have to give up. When you're a woman, you have to make choices, so you have to give up your career if you want to have one. On the other side, you have Sharon Samuel saying, when needed, the choice is yours. It's really up to you. You have to make those decisions. You have to understand it's a labyrinth. And it's not going to be simple. It's not a labyrinth that's going to make you get to the top. And you really have to be goal-oriented. You really have to know where to put your resources and your time. So my journey really started from that. And then having role modeling in my family. I had some really strong women, starting from my grandmother, to my aunt, to my own mother. And then having support from men in my family. In South Asia's context, you really cannot get further if you don't have men in your family supporting you. And that's something I learned when I was working with low-income women, especially when we started telling them, you know, you have to have your own businesses, you have to be independent, you have to make your own choices, you have to save. So the women, after a few years of our mobilizing them and activating them, came back to us and said, well, it's not about us. You have to talk to our men. And just to go back, how I got into microfinance, it was a man who mentored me, Dr. Bangladesh. It's when I met him and he really inspired me. And when I was going to start my organization in 1996, he said, microfinance is not rocket science, it's not nuclear physics. It's really about mindset change that will be your biggest challenge. that's really needed. I mean, as a woman, as an entrepreneur, others entrepreneurs willing to change that and tackle those sort of patriarchal norms, you're not going to make it.
How about you, sir? Because you also, along with many hats you wear, you're a director of the CEO, so it's a large car manufacturing exporter. Bangladesh, one of the biggest exporters of cars, especially in Bangladesh. So, again, very male dominated sort of environment. So, how do you, even molecular biology, in fact, research in a very male dominated environment? So, A, your journey is interesting, and I don't want to digress from the interesting journey from molecular biology to everything else, but I would like to touch upon that. But more than that, you know, again, within your specific environment, how has it been as a woman in Bangladesh? Challenges you might have faced, again, your journey.
I grew up in the UK and I moved to Chittagong in Bangladesh when I was 16. That was a huge culture shock. I had grown up in an environment where being a woman didn't seem to be a barrier. I mean, my father and mother both had encouraged me to sort of do anything that a man could do. And, I had dreams of becoming, you know, discovering, I guess, the cure for science and cancer or something like that. And I wanted to sort of study science and molecular biology, I think, from quite a young age, since 14, 15. So when I went to Bangladesh for the first time, Chittagong, I went to a state school in Bangla Medium. And I remember somebody, we had to choose between maths and biology as an optional subject. But a lot of the girls were like, oh my God, you know, we can't choose maths, why? Because, you know, we're women. And I'm like, let's all of us go and register and take maths, even though I wanted to do biology. It was just like the principle of it. Something happened to me in those 2 or 3 years, and I felt that there was a lot of potential in women there, but I hadn't really found women who were willing to sort of go that extra step. The path of women was like, okay, we'll get married. And in those days, not many women went abroad to study either, because it was thought, okay, if you go abroad to study, then you won't be able to get married or anything like that. So I went to study abroad in England, but something about Bangladesh had kind of invited to me, and I felt really strongly. I was very idealistic. I wanted to come back to Bangladesh and change the world, change Bangladesh. I felt that there was so much potential there. But as a third world, we needed to sort of find our solutions for ourselves. And when I moved back in the early 90s, that was when the garments industry was just taking off. There was a wave of garments industry starting off in 85, 86. And I had decided to, because it was very male dominated, and even though I had wanted to do biology, the pull of doing something for my country was stronger. And at the same time, I met an amazing group of women, a very small handful of women, but nonetheless amazing, and we had formed a small organization called NAIBOKO, which is a women's activist organization. And we were thought of as a very kind of fringe, radical group of women who thought these wild ideas that women should be equal as men. Even in the sense that anything that held us back, just primarily because of the thought that we are women. And that was what we wanted to fight. And we had a massive conference of small women's organizations all over Bangladesh. In the mid-90s, and we actually realized how many women thought exactly as we did, even though many of us were Western educated. And at the same time, I had decided to try working in the arms industry for a year, because I felt that it employed 80% women, and yet there was hardly any women in management. And I had to sort of face a sort of double whammy, in the sense that first of all, as a woman in management, was very unusual. And second of all, business had a very kind of negative connotation that, oh, you know, you're so well educated, blah, blah, blah. Why are you in business? And so that was the other thing, that I really felt that business was something that you could use your creativity and harness the amazing And you can do it as a woman in Bangladesh.
Excellent. We are speaking of businesses, you run your own business. It's a bookshop. Stepping away from the literary aspect of it, as a business, again, in Delhi, challenges, finding a place, rent, overheads, paying people, sourcing staff. It can't be easy. Again, India's predominantly patriarchal, male-dominated society. So again, it would be interesting to hear your challenges in terms of setting up a business and, you know, something that Roshani said earlier, I'd like us, you all, to comment a little bit about that a little bit more, is again the role modeling and the role of men in your lives, you know, and the support you've gotten from them in terms of sort of helping you guys achieve the goals that you wanted to or set for yourselves.
It's interesting you say that because I always say that the biggest feminist in my family is my father. With equal opportunities also came equal expectations of me and my brother, and that's an interesting phenomenon as well because I'm the elder of the sibling. So I had to kind of pave the way that if I'm going to educate you, you better do something with it as well. You can't just come back and sit at home. But like Sandra, I was also away from home for a long time, and I was living in London and I was working in publishing, and it was a very exciting time when things were happening in India. This was about 10 years ago. And when I first came back, there was a lot of excitement and enthusiasm, especially amongst a whole bunch of people who had now reclaimed Delhi or Bombay, the city, who were making it their own in terms of whether it was restaurants opening, bookshops opening, arts clubs opening. And that was the time that actually my brother and I both decided to open this bookshop called CMYK. And the idea was that not only was it an obvious extension to the publishing house that we ran, but it was also much needed space in a city like Delhi, where you have, it's almost, I'd like to believe, after 7 years, it's become a hub of anything to do with arts and creative people. You know, if you want to be able to do a bookbinding workshop, or you want to do an art appreciation class for children, there's a space available for you, and we also facilitate that. But talking about being an entrepreneur, I think, you know, I've also come from an industry where it's been very female dominated. I mean, publishing, as we know, is mostly driven by women. But again, it's a conscious decision as somebody who's in a place to be able to hold hiring. Is that how can I improve the situation or encourage more women who may not have ever thought of publishing as a career? I mean, it's not exactly the highest paying profession, so it may not be something that they would consider with the degree that they have. Or it could be something that requires long hours. I think this is something that they don't think about, because outside of reading, you also have to meet a lot of people. So how can you facilitate that? And I think these are the things that we have to be conscious as an entrepreneur. The flip side, of course, of that is that, yes, it's not easy setting things up in this part of the world as people. And dealing with, it's not as glamorous as dealing with all the people's lunches all the time. You have to deal with all kinds of licenses to be able to run a bookshop, customs officials when your books are stuck at the docks, you know, you have to figure that out. And it's been a learning process, but I have to say that things are changing as well. You know, I mean, maybe not as fast as we would like them to, but I think women are being, I wouldn't go as far as to say that we have the same weight, but I find that in the last 10 years since I've been back, people do take you more seriously, yeah, as they did before. I mean, as opposed to what they did before. But in our organization, and this is completely by default, this is not reverse discrimination, but every department is actually headed by a woman. Whether it's finance, which is not traditionally a place that you find women, except for the sales department, but editorial production, and finance, and they add our bookshops as well. They're all the women who work there, the managers of the bookshops.
So that's how you, your influences?
Well, my father has always encouraged me to, you know, I guess, dream big and never feel that being a woman should hold me back in anything. And then I have strong women, you know, my aunts, very, you know, as role models. I had that before me, and in fact my grandmother was actually a woman writer, and even though she had, you know, nine children, and she still managed to sort of exert that independence as a writer as well, and wrote, eight books. So I had that kind of before me. And I think the other thing was that you absolutely need, family support, because if you're going to do something like be in the garments business, they're very, very long hours, lots of traveling, and so, obviously the support of my husband has been paramount, I think, in that aspect as well.
I had another question which I just lost, but I'm going to put this down for a second, using my ability here. But I want to step away from the womanness for a second. Obviously, you guys have had the advantages of having strong characters and role models in your life that have sort of paved the way. But I was reading up on entrepreneurism a little bit yesterday, and recent studies have shown that there's psychologically, there's practically no difference between men and women when it comes to entrepreneurism, because there's a basic drive that drives you to step outside your comfort zone and take a step and do something on your own. So I'd like to talk a little bit about that, about being an entrepreneur for starters. What does it mean? What does entrepreneurism mean to each of you? How easy or difficult was it to take those steps, sort of say, that I'm not going to do the regular thing, or just have a 9-to-5 job, or just be married or have kids or whatever, but to really go out there and create something, because I think, to me, that's what entrepreneurism is about. It's about creating something that's going to outlast oneself, be it a work of art, be it an organization, be it a company. So I'd like for you guys to share a little bit about your ideas of what that means to you, and in terms of a legacy, and in terms of the challenges that you face as entrepreneurs. And if you think that there's anything additional that your being women has sort of created, or if there's nothing, or if it's all the same challenges that men might face as entrepreneurs.
Well, Omar, I got into this for similar reasons to what my peers commented on. I wanted to do something for the women of this country because I have never faced discrimination at all. I have three older brothers and then it was me. So my parents brought me up, and as you mentioned, Priya, my father was also the biggest feminist around us. And he never discriminated. I had the same choices as my brother had, and I was only two. When I did my A-levels, I had the same choices in terms of going to study and to be whatever I wanted to do. So when I came back, I thought I needed to do something for my country and for the women of my country, because I had been nurtured in society and I had lived here, and I wanted to give back to the women. However, I didn't know at that time that I was going to be able to do what I should do. So I ended up working for the World Bank, and I chose that path because I believe that would really allow me to understand the dynamics of women, especially from a low-income perspective. And that was an amazing journey because I got to hear thousands of women from across the country, from Neelam Valley down to Kala, and everywhere that I went, women say to me, "We don't have the same aspirations as you have. Just because you're educated doesn't make you much better than us. We want a better life for our families, we want a better life for our children, but we lack the economic wealth in order to make those choices." So this dynamic was always working in my head. How do we bring the economy to women? And what I've learned over the years is, unless or until women are empowered with money, it's not going to change the parameters in general in the family. So I kept thinking about this, and sometimes the fate is conspiring against you, the stars are aligning themselves. And I was at a conference similar to this, and Dr. Yunus was sitting next to me. I didn't know him at that time. And we struck up a conversation, and with Eureka, he was then with microfinance, was one thing of helping the millions of entrepreneurs in Pakistan who were struggling every day. And when you look at entrepreneurship from their perspective, it's really about being forced to get into this because it's a need. A lot of women in the low-income strata are really forced as entrepreneurs because the tragedy has struck. The husband has, there's illness that's struck, there's a health issue, there's some other thing that's happened, income sources have dried up. So they are forced to become entrepreneurs, but then they need the ecosystem to work with them. And that's what we do. We change that those parameters and those equations to them. So when I got into this space, I really didn't understand. I was 27 years old. I think in retrospect, if I had thought about it, I would have seen the risks and challenges much bigger than what they were. So I just started an organization. as you know, she perfected in her own field. She is enough. So she was one who came to me and said, and she spoke in Punjabi, so we always used to talk to them in that particular vernacular. So she came to me and she said, if you're going to do anything in your life, do it for the women of this country. And she was my first woman. So I think that whole process of ratification really helped me. In retrospect, yes, there were challenges, and they continue to be. When I fundraise, it's very different than when a man fundraises. I have a little child, so it's very difficult for me to take up the time. The old voice club begins to set in. So you have to make that time. So that work-life balance does become an issue over time.
I'd like to talk about that in a bit also. Another point you made, which I want to touch upon.
I think that I didn't get into it, to help women or anything like that. I got into it because I just thought that there was so much potential. I would have been a mastermind investor, as you mentioned earlier. But I wanted to be in Bangladesh, but I wanted to have, I guess, I make money. I wanted to have an equitable and socially aware company where people could we could tap into everybody's potential. They could also grow as well. And at the same time, as Bangladesh, as a company in Bangladesh, make ourselves kind of stand on our own feet, and be able to access have that sort of global reach and access that often you see businesses in the West. It's sort of a global dream where we could export everywhere. We could be a successful business. We could tap into the amazing amount of potential and energy and talent in Bangladesh. It was not necessarily just focused on the garments business, but that was very attractive because it employed a lot of women. And I think over time, it has actually been a symbol of where there has been change in real terms in women's empowerment, those employed in the industry. And the same thing happened when I started my travel company. When I was traveling around Bangladesh, I was in a moonlit night on a boat listening to Akhtar singing, and I just thought, this is like the most amazing experience in the world. Other people should experience this. And there's something intangibly beautiful about some kind of spirituality going around Bangladesh, which may be lost in 10, 15 years. And so I started a travel company doing customized travel tours around Bangladesh. And then our amazing heritage as well, that the rest of the world should know, because they don't know this. Started to do events to try and promote Bangladesh, and we did our first World Music Festival in Dhaka, which I was part of. And from then, that's what led me on to, and I was writing as well, so that's what led me on to do the Hay Festival, which is basically create a platform where our writers could be plugged into the global scene, and to promote Bangladeshi writers and to bring the world to Bangladesh so we could also be exposed to what's going on in the world. So I think this sort of drive to dream big and to meet the world on our own terms.
That's really interesting you said that, because I'm going to talk a little bit about how one thing leads to another thing as well, and that's very important as an entrepreneur to always be looking for the next idea that gets you thinking as well. But a few years ago, I remember these annoying forwards that you get full of cliches all the time, but there's one that I saved because it was so true. It said, do what you love and love what you do. And I think that's pretty much the motto of how one thing has led to another thing in my life. Whether it was the extension of publishing, to the bookshop, to doing festivals. A few years ago, we published this massive book on size in India, which took us 5 years to publish and the author 15 years to put together. And it was during that time when I was working with her that I realized that, for us it used to be a ceremonial outfit that we wore for a wedding. But what goes behind making a sari is so much a part of your culture. Every motif on that sari tells a story. So not only did I start wearing them, but I got involved in production of saris from the city that I come from, in Banaras. And then that led to a festival which I was talking to Lucy about yesterday, which is the Kabir Festival. But everything feeds into each other, whether it's your interests of music, textiles, art, books. And I think the point that I'm trying to say is that the most important ingredient in being
not only do doors open, but you create the time and the energy as well to be able to fulfill everything it is that you want to do.
One thing that I found interesting is that being someone myself who also started on I personally don't think that being a woman or being an entrepreneur are things that preclude each other at all from what being said. I think it's just anyone being an entrepreneur. But one thing that I did find interesting, it seems to be a common theme between the you three, is that it appears that all three of you have come from the mashallah privileged backgrounds. And one thing that sometimes, you know, I did a video on Facebook as well recently, and it was a guy, a South Asian guy, who wanted to start mentoring in South Asia, saying that, you know, it's really unfair that, you know, my sister gets to do whatever she wants to. She wants to go become a poet, an artist, she wants to go to university, she wants to get married, she can do whatever she wants to have, I'm a doctor, an engineer, you know, or a banker. So one question I have for you is, do you think that, how large a role do you think the fact that you have come from these empowered backgrounds plays in the fact that you have been able to sort of grasp your own destinies and take control of your own destinies? And the question I would have is that for women who may not have such strong backgrounds or education or have the exposure to be able to have the strength to take those steps specifically towards entrepreneurship, how would you encourage such other women to sort of, you know, break that mold or take that first step? Because it's always that first step that's the hardest. So how would you say to women who do not come from backgrounds such as yours, and you know, you want to do something, you have a passion, you have a dream, to follow it, but obviously not where there are circumstances, things that you said, yes, in our society there are women who are driven to entrepreneurism, whether it's cottage industry or whatever. So stepping away from that need and the necessity for when it's a passion. So how would you encourage women to say, what do you need to do to sort of do that?
That's interesting. Again, it takes me back in time, because when I started Lush, the mantra we had was microfinance for women by women. So we didn't used to hire women. So in 2000, this was in 1995 when we started. In 2003, I was at the support camp. A young man raised his hand and said to me, but aren't you discriminating as well against men by not hiring them? And that was when I began to rethink the whole dynamic around women's economic empowerment. And to understand how gender equity is everyone's issue. When you talk about gender, you have to talk about both. So after 2003, we began to hire men. And right now, in my organization, we have 2,000 staff. We have 200 offices across Pakistan. And we have about 1.5 million women set up successful businesses across the country. And we had to then really re-look at the dynamic of the organization that we run. For example, we had to start looking at flexing time. We had to start looking at mentoring women so that they could build their careers. A lot of times, we were getting these young women who were very qualified and were equally competent as the men. But they after their marriage, their entire relationship with their professions would change. So what we started doing, it's a very interesting concept. We started going at the future in-laws. So we invite them to our offices before the management space, and we say, have a cup of tea with us. Look at the environments and see the fact that no sexual harassment is going to happen in this workplace. We empower our staff who works with us. The men are trained on gender. The moment we hire a male staff, we actually train, we have gender training that we do with them. Starting from how do you send a text message to your female colleague, to would you send a Facebook. So we also have to look at how social media is changing the space between men and women and within the workplace. So a lot of these things we have to educate people. So I think if I was to do this again, the first thing I would do is go out to colleges. Right now in Pakistan, 54% of the enrollment in universities is women. And women are far outgrowing, and this is a dynamic you will see across South Asia. Women are far outgrowing their male counterparts in equity. However, in Pakistan, translating into women's involvement in the labor of participation. So for example, 12% is women, 12 to 20% is women's labor participation rate in Pakistan. So what's going on? And it's really about mindset. So if I was to do this, I would have career planning in universities. I would get them young. We would also work with the men so that their mindset would change as well. Because without that, you're not going to have female entrepreneurship. And if you look at what Sheryl Sandberg also says in her book, Meaning, she is saying you have to get the men involved. Without that, this whole thing is not going to change. And we see that even in the low-income families that we work with, the moment the man gets convinced, it's easier for them. I was just in Oshawa, which is, as you know, is one of the most conservative parts of the country. And you would be surprised that almost 80% of the capital that you provide is used directly in the businesses. For Punjab, that's 56%. So actually, what we forget is that men do also use a lot of stereotyping. So we would assume that women from the more conservative parts of the country would not be able to be entrepreneurs. But that's not true. Once they get an opportunity, they will go. That's been our experience.
How about you, Liz?
I also want to kind of flag the fact that even though of course I did have a very supportive family background, there's still a lot of challenges that you do have to face. I mean, even though my father was very encouraging, there is all of, you know, this sort of safety aspect or this idea that, you know, he was very protective in a lot of ways. And, you know, I think quite often there's a lot of things I had to fight because of that. That, you know, because if you're a woman, you can't do that because it's just not safe, or, you know, all of that sort of thing. And also, I think it's okay being a teacher or a university lecturer or a researcher or a doctor. But if you're an entrepreneur where you're like out day and night and you're traveling, that is not so acceptable. And I think in the early years, you do have to juggle things, and you have to give a lot in certain ways. When I first got married, I spent the first 12 years living in a joint family in my in-laws' house, and I think they had expected, you know, the wife of the family maybe would do something like a nice 9-to-5 job or a morning job or something like that. I took on my in-laws' family as my own, and you know, I would do a lot of things for my family, but at the same time, there were certain things I didn't compromise on. So, sort of years later, what would be unacceptable when I got seemed unacceptable when I got married, which is, you know, traveling around the world on my own, you know, coming back home sometimes 2, 3, 4 a.m. in the morning, trying to get a shipment out or whatever, or putting the hay festival on. I mean, normal and acceptable, but there are a lot of other things exactly. So it's not, and I think that is the path of many women that you negotiate, and it is compromise and negotiation and the certain battles that you
touch on this also, because Rashani mentioned something similar. How about you, Priya?
I think from what I see in India, there are four reasons why we don't. Which may be obstacles for more women coming in and joining the workforce. One is education, to be given education, opportunities, safety, and social norms. And I think the areas that we can help as entrepreneurs, that I feel like we can do something is, of course, safety, ensuring that, you know, even if that goes down to basically ensuring that the relationship between your male colleagues and female colleagues, setting certain norms, making sure that you're giving them an environment that they're comfortable and their families are comfortable. To step out of the house. And as far as opportunities are concerned, we realized a few years ago that there is so much talent which is not being tapped by women who now, because they've left the workforce after having their children and they don't have the kind of help that they need to be able to come back. But there's a lot of latent talent there, especially for the kind of work that we do, when you don't require them to be in an office. You could be editing, you could be reviewing manuscripts, you could be working with authors. And so two friends of mine, along with them, we started something called Ghar Kamai, not Ghar Jamai, but gharkamai.com. And it was basically just that. So there are a lot of people who once upload their CVs, and employers who were looking for women to be kind of, whether it was a project-based work, whether they required them to come into offices. And it was a real learning experience, because what we realized was that there was, from both sides, there was such a need for something like this to happen as well. So I think from just going back to what we were talking about as entrepreneurs, some of these are also our responsibilities in whatever little way that you can to try and help other women, even those who may
Clint, you touched upon something which I want to talk about, and that's the sort of, I'm going to bring two aspects. One is the sort of work-life balance. As professional women, work-life balance is tough, irrespective, anywhere in the world. It's hard, you know, being a mother, being a wife, being a professional. As an entrepreneur, it's also more so because you don't switch it off. It's 24/7. It's not a 9-to-5. More so in South Asia because, as you mentioned, and we were talking earlier, the role of the woman is not just a nuclear family. I mean, as when you get married, you're dealing with the entire family. So your expectations as a woman are there. You have to meet those expectations as a daughter-in-law, as a daughter, as a wife, as a mother. And at the same time, you have to be, you know, running your organizations or businesses, which require as well, those your babies also. So how do you maintain that work-life balance, A, and B, something that Priya touched upon is the technological aspect of it. How much do you think as technology, especially mobile technology and the ability to work remotely, again, help empower them to sort of be on the phone, to take those steps?
I think technology definitely helps. For example, I have a nanny cam, so I can watch what's happening at home. So that way, you know, takes the fear off your head that something's going to go wrong. So technology can help us to a large extent. We do have people in our office also where we love this, and they come in and work. I myself can just monitor my work through my at home. I can do that. Or when I travel, I can do that as well. I think a lot of it, when you are an entrepreneur, as you mature, it changes with that. But you are the one where the buck stops. It's hard. And then it's just the jumping act becomes harder. But as you mature and your organization mature, you have to look into succession plans. You have to build the next tier of leadership. Otherwise, you're not going to be able to do this on your own. So the team part of it is very important. And luckily for me, you know, Pakistan doesn't lack talent. That's the narrative we have to change. For this country, we have to take that narrative and we have to provide opportunity to the talent in Pakistan. So that's why indigenous organizations are really, really important. So I think for me, and I'm very lucky, I have 6 to 10 people in my organization who can run the organization. I get it by myself. The organization will die, the mission will continue. So that really takes the burden off. And so that is one thing. Technology definitely, as I said, will also help women to set businesses out from their homes. That is certainly. But again, that depends from its strategy. If you're talking about going to women, who want to go to run businesses, their challenges are very similar to what Priya said. It's financial, it's outreach, it's networking, it's markets, it's social norms, it's also lack of property rights, or legal rights, or voice for that matter. All of those things we deal with. For women like us, of course, technology can help us in more ways than one. And it can be a driver, change it, you can start a business in your home. That works, if your office is in your home, you can manage it. I have a lot of women in my peer group who are actually doing that.
Technology certainly helping me right now, for example. I think I'm like BlackBerry 5 different email addresses different. Following the, we do have the team, which is amazing. But then, you know, you're constantly like checking back and forth. But still in Bangladesh, you know, there's a lot of stuff that you just absolutely need to be there on the ground and there's that constant having just to be there and solve things or you know, give that extra impetus to something getting solved, I think.
So how do you then specifically, Charlie should think about that, she sort of manages that balance. How do you specifically manage that balance between family and your other baby?
Not in multitasking, we're running around again this chicken. exactly the same points that you were making as well, and building up different parts of the team and trusting them to run with it. But being there at specific points to make sure that it does go through, because I think there's so many barriers in countries like ours, and you always have to be concerned about closing the loop every single step of the way. And I think that's like needs to be reinforced all the time.
I completely agree with what you're saying. I think it's all about building a team that you can rely on as well. And
may have to give up on a certain work commitment, and then other days you have to give up family commitment for work. But these are all choices that you have to weigh in at the end of the day. And you're completely right. I mean, in this part of the world, you're not just answerable to your immediate family, but there's so much more to that than, you know, especially as a woman or the daughter of the house that you're expected to be there. But I think you just kind of have to learn to juggle and prioritize and make choices.
Just to add to that, it's also about the mentors you have. That really helps, that ratifies. If you're in a soup worrying and trouble, you can always go to those mentors and they can help you. And that's also been one of the ways that I've managed different compartments of my life.
Excellent. I think we have like a few minutes. So we open it up to questions. Because women here, if you talk to them about those issues, if not somehow own, this is my, from my personal experience, maybe it's an assumption or something, but this is how I got from my experience.
I think very quickly it's about education itself. It's about it, the curriculum we use. It's for, very simple. Agar aap hamara Urdu ka curriculum uthaye to usme jo ladki hai wo bahar wo ghar mein baith ke bartan saaf kar rahi hai jo bachcha hai wo bahar ja raha hai. So jab aap shuru se gender roles ko typify karte hain and you limit women's roles from the very beginning, it becomes part of the thinking. So we really have to get it from in the curriculum itself. We have to change the way we educate our young.
I also don't think that feminism necessarily only means you have to leave your house to go out and get a job. It's also equal opportunities and equal say, equal rights within the house as well. And I think that's very important to also teach young girls and young women. I just want to address the point that you made that it's not in our culture. And I remember when I'd come to Bangladesh with all of these, you know, ideas that, you know, I would do all of this with women in Bangladesh, and my cousin had told me, don't import your Western ideas, our women are not like that. And I talked to women from 550 organizations, women-led small organizations from all over Bangladesh, from all 64 districts. And you know, we're talking of a country of 150 million people. And we had a series of workshops on women and religion, women and culture, women and health, women and reproductive rights, women and law. And what was overwhelming was how similar all felt about what our law was. Many women wanted to work in the home and have microcredit access. Many of the women wanted to go out and work. It's a reflection of men and women, what they want to do. Some people are entrepreneurs, some people want a steady job, some people want a job in the home, some people want to go out and earn a living, some people want to be homemakers and bring their children up that way. And it's universally, you know, that rang universal. So I don't think there's anything about their culture and our culture. Sometimes maybe there might be a barrier of what I think I should say or what I'm being brought up in, and it might not reflect what's in my heart. But I think that as women, and one of the biggest barriers that we identified way back in the 90s for women to reach their potential was the threat of violence and violence. That was the thing.
सवाल ये है कि क्या जब हम यहाँ पर बात कर रहे हैं और खवातीन की तरक्की और खवातीन आगे बढ़ रही हैं और मर्दों की शाना बशाना काम कर रही हैं, इस पर फिक्र करते हैं कि ऐसा तो नहीं है कि क्या हम सिर्फ एक पुस्तक के खवातीन में फिक्र करें जो जिनको मौाक़ मैसर हैं, जो शहरों में हैं, जो मर्दों की शाना बशाना काम कर रहे हैं, जबकि गाँव देहातों में अभी भी खवातीन की हालात जो हैं वो बहुत ही दल हैं और उनको सिर्फ खाने पकाने से या बच्चे पैदा करने से अधिक वो नहीं दिए जाते हमारे मुआशरे में.
I'd like to thank our panelists. I'd like to me to the business world is that really, we talked about women and entrepreneurism, that was the subject, and to me it's almost as if, as I said earlier, it's kind of almost a no-brainer. Because to me, it's the challenges of being an entrepreneur, the challenges of being an entrepreneur, irrespective of whether you're a man or a woman, the mindset that goes into it is irrespective of whether you're a man or a woman. And I think the challenges that you mentioned are the challenges that women in South Asia would have to overcome, perhaps, irrespective of whether they were entrepreneurs or professionals or even just housewives or homemakers. So, thank you so much for your time. Thank you, everyone, for coming.
The Vertical Atlas for yoga, which was supposed to be held in Hall 1, is now in Hall 2, and in the Vertical World,